really.
Okay, welcome everybody. That was a very nice, relaxing meditation, and it kind of fits into our talk. I always feel kind of like Rachel Maddow. Who, y'all watch Rachel Maddow? She always says, "Well, we have a lot of, you know, a good show tonight." So, and as usual, I'm in a complete dead zone all week, stewing about stuff, and then it just comes to a head on Tuesday. Usually on Wednesday or Tuesday morning, and everything congeals. Even my conversation with Errol coming here just brought so many things together, which I put up on the board. But the first thing was y'all talking about squirrels. And what a great metaphor, I realized. The squirrel, everybody relates to the problem of keeping the squirrel out of the bird feeder. I mean, it will drive you to a nervous breakdown because squirrels are very intelligent, and they seem to evolve that with the different bird feeders will create a tension between the seed and the squirrel, and he will evolve his intelligence to get into that bird feeder. You know, you can watch him do it. It's really fascinating. It's through trial and error. And then one will figure out how to do it, and then all the others will copy, you know. So we're really, human beings have really advanced and evolved the intelligence of squirrels. But it's a metaphor because the squirrels always win. Okay, well, what's the metaphor? Well, squirrel, you could say, equals change or life. And the bird feeder represents our idea to contain change. So the bird feeder then is like it's an idea because we create the bird feeder. It's created out of thought. Somebody has an idea for a bird feeder. And the purpose of the bird feeder is to feed the beautiful birds. So you can see, oh, how everything is lovely. The birds come and you get the song and all that, you see. And then the squirrels come and eat the birds' food, you know. So the squirrels are a threat, you see, to this idea. And the idea then wants to contain, the squirrel is nature. The squirrel is being itself, you know. So the idea, man has the idea, I create the idea of the bird feeder, now the squirrel, you see, is a threat to my idea. So my idea, see, this is a metaphor for the fact that my idea to contain time is always being eaten by the squirrels of time. So even our retirement, you see. So if I have the idea of a perfect retirement, and I'm going to have all of these beautiful things, I'll work my whole life, you know, and have savings and all this, get everything just right, and then I retire, and then the squirrels eat it. And the squirrels are good because they gnaw at it. You know, they will gnaw through anything, right? You know, to get to my seed. So there's this eternal conflict between the bird, my idea of perfection and stability and containment, and this damn squirrel who is constantly gnawing away at it, you know. And in the end, the squirrel wins. Okay? So it's just a great metaphor.
My husband had bought a squirrel called the Yankee Clipper. The squirrels would get on it, and they got on it and swung them off.
Yeah, there's two. I have one where the legs, the arms collapse. And the other one is where it whirls and spins them off, yeah. But even then, they figured out how they will come up and leap up from the bottom and grab hold of the bottom and then reach up and get a little seed off the side.
When you think about comparison to life, this is all fine unless you're a squirrel. The squirrel also has to eat.
Well, sure.
So I do provide him a corn cob.
Yeah.
Right. And a place to get something.
Yeah, so that's a bargain. I mean, you know, so we bargained with it.
But when you get to the Middle East and here, in Christianity, Muslim, whatever, you know, we all have to exist somehow. And
right.
Figuring out a way to feed all of them,
right,
and have them all live.
Well, there you got three philosophies right there. So you go to the East, other cultures, and they would probably look at that as being insane. You know, why just let the squirrels and the birds all live naturally. You know, why do you want to, just let nature take its course, all right? And then you have the Western idea of creating a reality out of our ideas, and then that creates an opposite, which is the squirrels, right? And then you have the bargain, you know, the compromise. You know, well, we'll have the bird feeder, but then I'll give something to the squirrels too. All right, so there's three philosophies right there. Okay, so if we just for a moment stop at our, just go back to our relaxation, okay, and recall what happens when we have a relaxation like that, because I was just observing myself. So the instructions are to relax into being slash body. Okay. So the instructions are in the from the speaker was to just relax into your body and being through the different sections of the being, the feet, so on, you know. And so there is a squirrel here. Okay, the squirrel is thought. What idea? Okay, so the instructions are relax into the body. Now the body, if you notice, when you go into your body, there's no, when you really relax into your feet, there are no feet. I mean, you know, feet is an idea. There is no such thing as a foot. There's the idea of a foot, but where does the foot end and where does the foot begin, you see? That's an arbitrary line around, or say finger, all right, well, finger's a thing, all right, well, where does the finger end? I mean, does it exist without the body? See, so the finger is an interrelated part of the whole body. And then, of course, where does the body end and the body begin? I mean, the body requires earth, air, sun, ground. See, so where, everything is arbitrary. You see, there is no boundary in being, in reality, except what we apply to it as an idea. So right away, you're set up in the relaxation as a conflict between idea and being. The instructions are to relax into being, and that means relax thinking about the foot. You just want to just relax into the, and then when you relax into the foot, you can't find it. You see, so you're relaxing the idea's grip on being, on reality. And of course, then you have the ticker tape going by where you start thinking about something. Right? So then you notice that, and then you go back. So there's two thinking, you know, there's two squirrels going on here. The first squirrel is the idea of my foot that I want to relax. And then there's the thinking, ticker tape going by, which is like a squirrel running across the bottom of the mind. Say, oh, did I, you know, it's getting warm, you know, you start thinking. And then you stop, then you go thinking, and then you go back to the idea. Well, what idea was I working on? I was working on the idea of my knee. And even there, we have to relax that, you see. So we're constantly relaxing the idea and the tension of the idea with being, or mind and matter. So I just found that to be interesting as a play on this metaphor of that. Which brings us into...
Can I make a comment?
Yeah.
So this is very interesting how you tie to relaxation.
Yeah.
What I feel is so obvious that I find it effective relaxation, because when you move through the body parts,
yeah,
you are really dissolving your thoughts, and you are dissolving the idea of your body and coming to your heart where the pure consciousness is.
Yes. Okay. Okay, yeah, what, heart and head. These are two, I'm glad you brought that up, because you could say heart is being, and head is mind, okay? So head is the seat of the mind, and heart is the seat of being, okay? And these two are in conflict, like the squirrel and the bird feeder. Because being, you know, well, even when we say heart, that's still mind. If I say heart, I'm thinking, well, where is heart? Well, it's here. Okay, so now I have located heart by an idea. But that's not the heart. See, the heart is transcendent of, or let's say it contains, or there's no boundary to heart. That's why they say love is from the heart. Well, there's no boundary to love or conditions on love. So there is a certain unconditional and this is conditioned. Okay, so there's these two elements here. The love is unconditional. Mind is conditioned by ideas. Okay? So we even divide these into female and male. I mean, this really, or you could, you know, it's kind of like we have different ways of looking at the same pair of opposites, you know. So, or you could say the mother is the heart and the father is the mind, which would be ideas, reason, and so forth like that. So you've got logic here, and you got heart.
Feeling.
Huh?
Feeling?
Yeah, feeling would be here. Thinking would be here. Logic versus art would be here. So we can, you know, if you start playing with this, you can really keep on going with different ways. This fundamental ambiguity, okay. Now, what is ambiguity first? Ambiguity means, this is an eraser and this is not, this is a marker and this is not a marker. Which is it?
Both. Schrodinger's marker.
Yeah, right. In other words, it creates an equivalency that cannot be resolved because each equals the other. And this is not logical because logic, which is the operational system of thinking, says this is an eraser and it's not a bottle of water. It can't be a bottle of water and eraser at the same time. But if it was in a dream, I might have this eraser and suddenly I could drink it. Or if I was in a Salvador Dali painting, you see, I might have this eraser and then suddenly I might drink the ink from it, you see. I would, you know, so in other words, ambiguity is contained. Ambiguity, this is this and this is not this, is contained in the dream and in art. But it's not contained in logic or thought or the mind. So ambiguity is contained in the heart, but not in the mind. So you have a conflict here that is going on between certainty and uncertainty. Okay? Certainty means I know this is a marker. You see? So you know what something is. And when I know what something is, I also know who I am in relationship to what I know it is, you see. But as soon as this becomes uncertain, I become uncertain. Because I know myself by the certainty I make in reality. So if you know somebody is good or bad, that anchors you, in but if they suddenly become ambiguous, you don't know who you are in relationship to them. You see? So we have a basic need for certainty, because it establishes ourselves in reality. Otherwise, you're threatened by psychosis. Psychosis is having no center. I don't know, there's just stuff going on. There's no center. There's no me, you see, to the psychotic. It's a very terrifying place to be, because there's no me that centers the world. So you can say then there's a certain tension between certainty, we need certainty, but at the same time, is reality certain? You see, we discover as we get older that nothing is certain. You can say, oh, I've got a certain retirement. And the next thing you know, you don't have a certain retirement. It's uncertain, you know. I'm going to live till I'm 100. It's uncertain. I could die when I walk out of here. So everything is uncertain, but at the same time, we do have a need for certainty, otherwise we couldn't function. You know? So this is so we're playing with the understanding of this ambiguity. And I remember these my two favorite movies, and I just watched. Okay, has anybody watched the Netflix production called Narcos?
I watched part of it, yeah. It's good.
It's about to bring you up, it's a very simple story, but it's a historical story about Pablo Escobar, who created the Medellin cartel, which was the first cartel to import cocaine into Miami, if you remember Miami Vice. Well, that was about when cocaine came to Miami. And the Medellin cartel, Pablo Escobar, was a local smuggler and a chemist, or some guy who figured out how to create powder cocaine was in Chile. And when the CIA uprooted the government of Chile and installed the dictator, the dictator started killing all the drug traffickers. And so this guy escaped with his formula, the cocaine. And he went to Pablo Escobar, who already had a little smuggling set up going to Miami, and said, they're going to really like this stuff in Miami. So he just put it into his smuggling operation, sent it to Miami, and Miami got addicted. They loved it. So then the money started pouring in. Just how much money they have to bury it in holes in the ground, you know. And so Pablo started, he had to spend the money, so he started building schools and playgrounds and hospitals and stuff for Medellin, this was his town. So he became like the Robin Hood. And so they protected him, everybody loved him. So he wanted to become president because he wanted to do good for Colombia. He loved his people. So then he ran he got elected to Congress. But when he found out that of course everybody knew he was a drug trafficker. You know, so he was kind of like a Trump in the sense that he wanted to be accepted among the elite and the power families, but he was just a poor guy with drugs. So he never could, you know, his money didn't really carry any weight, but he wanted to get up there. So they told him to leave Congress because they found out that he had been arrested for a minor drug offense, and they put his little picture of him being arrested up on the screen, you know, and said, you know, ashamed him. So he left, and he was very, you know, upset. His dream was denied. And so then when they started to, the DEA came down there to get rid of the drug cartel, Pablo Escobar. And so then as his enemies began to build up, he started killing them. And so the drug war escalated. So there were big bombs and it was an insane thing. So then the Cali cartel, which was another cartel that was very small at that time, I wanted to come up. So they started attacking. And then the DEA, and they got in hard with this guerrilla, very vicious guerrilla group, farce or something. And so they, anyway, the whole thing evolved to the point where they finally stripped Pablo of his money and his men, and finally cornered him and shot him. And then the Cali cartel was off. So they took over. So the thing ends with the DEA agent who had been there to find, the goal of his whole existence was to kill Pablo and get rid of this cartel. And so then it ends with the U.S. intelligence questioning the DEA and saying, now, what do you know about the Cali cartel? Because now the Cali cartel had replaced them. It means nothing. The squirrel still won. No, they couldn't get squirrel. Obviously. But the point that, what struck me about it was that of the ambiguity about Pablo Escobar. And the ambiguity is Pablo good or is Pablo bad?
Right.
So to the people, Pablo is good. To his mother, he was very devoted, loved his wife. And in fact, that's how he got killed, was they got caught, was because he had a radio phone and he kept calling his wife. And they tracked the phone to where he was, you see. So, so as the movie portrays, no, this is all movie. But anyway, he was a family man, he loved his wife, he loved his children dearly, and he wanted to do good for the people and all that, but he was a killer. So he was good and bad. And in the end, the people decided he was good, and so they were glad the devil was dead. But before that, because he really got to extremes, you know, and all that. But before that, Pablo could do no wrong. So there was a flip there. Pablo was good to the people, then suddenly at the end, yay, Pablo's dead. Pablo was bad. Okay? But so the idea where the movie presents, and I remember the first time I really saw this ambiguity in a movie was Bonnie and Clyde. Y'all remember Bonnie and Clyde? Well, Bonnie and Clyde were pictured as just good folks without Rob Banks, right? So this is kind of like the American movie, where, you know, it's an art form, but it's creating a good slash bad guy.
It's because all of the people that they stole from were rich.
Yeah. Yeah, it was kind of like Jesse James.
Yeah.
Steal from the trains. So the whole idea, which I remember about Bonnie and Clyde, was he was a very sympathetic. They were just folks. So it's the idea that we're playing around here. Is that this ambiguity is a double bind. Now, a double bind means, and I go back to Zen, because Zen is full of, the whole thing about Zen is double binds. If you call this a marker, you're wrong. If you say it is not, if you say it is a marker, you're wrong, and I'll smack you. If you say it isn't a marker, you're wrong, and I'll smack you. Now, which is it?
I know the answer. No, I really do.
Yeah. Keep it to yourself.
Okay.
Now, here's where the Zen works, you see. So the Zen master gives his disciple a koan that he has to figure out, which, just use the one I just gave you, right? They're all little puzzles like that. So the disciple experiences now the tension between the heart and the mind. All right, so the tension of the implication of the koan is that there is an answer. And I'm going to punish you if you don't come up with it. Right? So now you know there is an answer because the master gave it to you. And you have to come up with a certainty. What's the answer? You see? So now you've got a tension. That's like in Zen, it's called a white hot ball in your throat that you can't cough up or swallow. It's called the great doubt. You've got this problem, okay? And we all have these little white things when we have a problem that the mind can't solve, like should I move or not? Or should I leave this person or not? Or should I go to California or not? Or we know when we have these things because they become a little vortex. So thinking runs around this thing trying to solve it. And it's kind of like when you lose the keys and you keep looking under the same magazine 30 times, thinking, well, maybe I didn't see it the first time. So you start, when you start thinking in the same place or looking in the same place, you know from this practice you're caught in the double bind. Something is this and something is not this at the same time, and that can't be because you can only have one. In other words, the law of life, the law of the universe, is basically let there be one. There can only be one reality. If there's two, you're schizophrenic. You see what I mean? There's only one. There's only one room here. You know, someone might come in and say, "Well, no, there's really parallel rooms. That we're all in another room at the same thing." But there's, what you see, that's just a way to bargain out of the ambiguity. So you can bargain out of the ambiguity by saying, "Well, there's a parallel universe." That's, you know, so that, you know, but anyway, we don't want to go there. But anyway, the thing is that the ambiguity cannot be escaped by the logical mind. So that's the whole point. This is the squirrel in the bird cage, the squirrel in the bird feeder, or the coyote and the rabbit. Okay, you know, so the all of the cartoons are about this. So this tension of the double bind will begin to accelerate, like if you take the mic and put it up at the amplifier, you get the wah, 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 wah. So then you start screaming, turn it off, I can't stand it. So this happens in the mind when an ambiguity cannot be contained. Because they keep going, whoa, 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 you see. Is it this? Is it that? Is it this? Is it that? No, yeah, right? So you can watch this happen when we get into a fix like this in our own personal life over some ambiguity in life that can't be solved by thinking about it. So the ambiguity in a spiritual sense is kind of like the pirate's plank. So the coin, or the ambiguity, or the double bind, pushes us off the pirates. You know, we get up to the edge of the plank, you know, and we don't, and the unknown is there. Of course, in the movies, what is it? Sharks. But sharks is a metaphor for uncertainty. So you see where we're moving here. When you put the mind in a fix, okay, an ambiguous fix or a double bind, it pushes us towards this, to the heart. But we live in, because our culture lives in the mind, we live in a thought-based world, we have no idea who's there. So we resist. We cling to certainty, but when certainty is pulled away, we have a panic attack. You see, so this whole, there's different levels to this. See, it's a very mundane level. Do I need to go to Walmart or not? You know, or do I need to buy a new air conditioner? You know, whatever our little mundane little household things are. Or basically, a little bitty bird cage, bird feeder, you know, when you get all the way up to who am I, the question of who am I? There's a story, a Zen story, of the tenth man. Let's talk about this right here. All right. So there's 10 people had to get across the river, and they all got to the other side, and then he wanted to check to see if everybody had made it. So every one of them, everybody came up with 9 people. So we've lost somebody. So somebody, a stranger, came along and said, we can't, no matter how we count, we feel like we've lost somebody. Somebody didn't make it across. Would you count? And he counts, and he says, there are 10 people. Well, the answer is that the people that didn't count the, you know, the first counters were wrong, and the stranger was wrong. Why is the stranger wrong? He said there were 10 people. He counted
himself.
Huh?
Counted himself? I don't know.
Even if he said there are 11 people, he's wrong. See, now this is the same. Why is, who is not being counted? The counter. The counter is never counted. I mean, end of story. Now, of course, you could go back and say, well, I'm blind, you know, but that this is the point. The point is that the counter is not, the one counting is not an object to be counted.
Now just think, you have to dwell
with this a minute. The counter is not counted because the counter is not an object to be counted. You can only count objects, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? And even if I count myself, I'm still wrong because the counter can never be counted because the counter is not an object, okay? So there's another form, you know, that, let's get back to, well, okay, just stopping back on Pablo Escobar, is Pablo good or is Pablo bad? Okay, well, that would mean he's an object. You know, if I say he's a good object because he did that, he did these behaviors, or he's a bad object because he did these behaviors. But this is, but you would quickly divide into, it would split, you see, immediately into two groups of people. The ones who say he's good, the ones who said he's bad. Now we're talking about Trump. Or any politician, or Clinton, you see. Is Clinton good or bad? Is Trump good or bad? And then you have the people who will take one side or the other. But who can take, who can say they're both good and bad? You see what I mean? The counter here, the only unity that holds these opposites is the counter. So the counter, the one counting, or the one judging, is one. But unless the counter knows himself, the counter counts himself in the good or bad side. So what happens in our political thing is that will join this side, or I might join that side. So if I say Trump is good, then I'm not going to be the counter, I'm going to be somebody who is counted among that group. And then those who don't like Trump will, see, form here, and me will count themselves in that group. But the counter is still missing. This is, as I work with this right now, you know, as I explore this right now, this requires a certain leap. This invites us to make a leap to see something that is not there because it's not an object. When you count something, it's an object. But the counter is not an object. So the counter is uncertain. The counter has no idea or form. So the counter would be the heart, and the counted would be the idea. Does see if I'm going to, how many markers do you have? Well, I have one, I just counted it, but there might be a whole basket of them, and then I would count them, you see. So you can't count something unless it exists as an idea. If you go prior to the idea, well, then it would just be a basket full of plastic. You see, but as soon as you say eraser, I have created this thing as an object now that's distinguished from other things, and I can count them. And then I would say it exists, you see. But when I do that, it also creates myself as the subject, as an object. But what we're struggling to grasp here, oh, okay, so when I count the Trump people as either good or bad, and then I decide which side I'm going to count myself in on, you see. I'll join this and I count myself in there. I say Trump is this, okay? And then I'm saying that would be, if Trump is good, that is the truth, Trump is good. But now I've got the problem of Trump is this. All right, so now there's evidence that shows Trump is not perfect. So there's imperfection here. Okay. So you see the dilemma that we get ourselves into. So if Trump is good, that means Trump is okay, Trump is perfect, and I'm with him, so I'm good and I'm perfect, in that kind of a sense, you see. And then those people that say he's bad are enemies, wrong, deluded, whatever. I discount them. But the evidence is that he is both. In the same way with Escobar, the evidence is that he did good for the people, so he's good. He also killed the people, so he's bad. So who is Escobar? So the question is, how do we contain the tension of the ambiguity? The ambiguity is Trump is good, Trump is bad. Which is, now if you say Trump is good, you're wrong. If you say he's bad, you're wrong. Now which is it? You see? Or if you say Clinton is good, you're wrong. Clinton is bad, you're wrong.
They are what they are.
Now which is
it? Right, they are
what
they are. What? They are what they are. It's neither good or bad, it's mix of both.
Yes, but then how can this, see where we're getting into problems. Here we have an eraser and a bottle of water. This is an eraser, this is a bottle of water. Now, this is this, and this can't be this. Both at the same, can't be an eraser and a bottle of water at the same time, unless it's in a dream.
Okay.
It's in a dream, I can write with this, okay? So in the dream, the ambiguity is unified. So there is no way to unify. Trump can't be both this and this at the same, good and bad, at the same time. We could say maybe they're both. I think that's what you were saying. But they're not the same. You're holding them in parallel. Or you're saying here Trump is both dark and light. But that doesn't solve, but you still have a tension between. You can only have to see the imperative is there is only one, and one is not two. So we have to find we're driven by DNA, by evolution, or by God to find the one that it has no second.
You basically have to let go of both.
Yeah. All right, now we're moving into that, and what you come up with when you let go of your division, of your dividing line, your judgment, because this is judgment, I make a judgment, he's good, I make a judgment, he's bad. So now you get to a religious imperative, don't judge. Okay, so see where we're getting with this don't judge identity through my judgment. You see, it's my judgment of who's good or bad that gives me an identity. So if I let go of the judgment, I'm going over here to the heart. You see, I'm going over here where logic and certainty can't go. Certainty is over here. I'm certain Trump is good. Or I'm certain Trump is bad, or Clinton, you see. And we stake our identity on that certainty. Even to the point of death, somebody will not give up, you know, this extreme cases, you know. So if you let go of the judgment, well, let's stop for a minute. Do you remember the, let me go to another movie. The Life of Pi. Did everybody, is it getting hot in here?
I'll turn it down.
I'm getting hot.
Okay.
Did you turn it back up?
No.
He was in a family with zookeepers, and they were going to Canada, and they had all the animals on a ship, and the ship was in a storm and sank. So he ended up in a rowboat with a tiger. Okay, and so the story then begins with this reporter coming to this to Pi's house when he's all grown up. And wants to know about the story. So he's telling the story to a reporter, but he's telling the story to the viewer. So the reporter is the movie viewer, you and me. So we're watching the movie. The movie is telling the story to me as the adult Pi is telling the story to the reporter. So he tells the story of this grand adventure of the boy with the tiger and how he came to survive with a Bengal tiger in the boat. So it's a very, it's both mythic and spiritual, because there is a dilemma here. There's a metaphorical meaning here, is who is the tiger? The tiger is the squirrel, and Pi is the bird feeder. How do I stay alive with this tiger who wants to eat me? So he has to figure out, you know, and he goes through all these adventures, and it's a wondrous movie about wonder, all, you know, whales and phosphorus and flying fish and everything. So it's a magical story. So it's a magical wonder. It's a magical story. The one very magical part, which really makes you suspect the factuality of the story, is that he lands up on an island called the Carnivorous Island. Of course, they're starving, he and the tiger. And they end up on this island, and it's full of meerkats and pools of water. They can stay there forever. But then he discovers that at night, the pools turn to acid. So he had to get off the island because the island would consume him. And he said as he left, the Carnivorous Island, what it gives to you during the day, it takes away at night. And this is a metaphor for the world. This is a metaphor for the ambiguity of life that gives during the day and takes away at night. Myths are full of this. Penelope with Odysseus. She knits during the day and unravels it at night. You see, so this is the eternal myth of life. Give mother. The mother gives. Mother is life. Gives with one hand and takes you back with this. So in Indian mythology is full of this, where a god is a destroyer, creator, and a destroyer. God gives and takes. So the Carnivorous Island is kind of like a metaphor for that. So he leaves. So he leaves the world. Interesting enough, when I watched this movie the second time, I noticed that as he left the island, and he could see it in the dim twilight of the evening, it was Vishnu lying on his side.
Yep.
And that was a myth. The Indian myth is that Vishnu dreams the world out of his name. He goes and he finally, he discovers the secret of his koan, the Zen koan he's put in, is how do you survive with a Bengal tiger who wants to eat you, because it wants to survive. So life is the Bengal tiger, and it wants to eat you. How do you survive? He survives by feeding the tiger. He survives by learning how to fish and feeding the tiger. So he learns to survive by feeding life. He even has great compassion. The tiger's dying of starvation and he cries, holding the tiger's head. So he had great compassion for the tiger. And then when they finally land on the shore, the tiger just gets up and walks off into the jungle. And when Pi was telling the story, he said that was the one thing that hurt so much, that the tiger didn't even turn around and say goodbye. It just got out of the boat and just walked off into the jungle. And so he did. It was an impersonal relationship, where it was for Pi as a human being, it's a personal relationship. So anyway, he tells the story to the reporter, and then the reporter says, there was another story that the newspapers reported. So that story was that the boy got in the lifeboat, and there was a cook on the ship who was kind of a nasty guy, and he was in the lifeboat too. And there were some other people, the boy's mother and something, and the cook killed them to eat him, and he had to kill the cook. So it was a really, you know, and so finally he survived by eating the cook. Something like that. But it was a very meaningless, degrading, unheroic story of cannibalism. So the movie ends. I've forgotten now. But the movie ends with Pi saying, "Well, which one? You know, the reporter says, well, which one was true?" And he says, "Well, the only thing we know is that there was a ship and it sank and a boy ended up." So we don't know. The only facts are there was a ship, it sank. And that there was a boy who survived. All the rest is ambiguous. So what unites? This has really been going off of me like that white hot thing. You know, ever since I've seen it, I've been trying to figure this movie out. You know, so I've been trying to figure out logically, with certainty, what the movie means, and you can't come up with it because. If you say it was just a boy with a cook, there's no wonder, there's no discovery, there's no wisdom. It's just yuck.
Survival.
Yeah, survival. You know, there's no meaning to it. If it's just the boy with the tiger, then that has no factual basis because there's no such thing as a carnivorous island. You see? So the factual interpretation gives you no meaning whatsoever. The mystical meaning gives you meaning and wonder and wisdom, but no facts, no logic. You see, so we're dealing back here with the boy with the tiger is the heart. It's metaphorical, it's a dream, but it teaches life, wisdom. The other story is logical, but it teaches nothing. Has no value, no meaning, you see. So which do we still, we can't have one, we can't have our life can't live on this side because it has no meaning, no value to it. It's just a tale of survival of the fittest, doggy dog. You know, this is just a rather tale told by idiots, meaning nothing. On this side, you have heroicism, the heroic, the meaning, the value, but it's not based in logic, you see? So then you get here, well, there's another division, faith and reason. Okay, so you get, our society divides into this. You know, science will be on this side, religion would be on this side. So is the Bible based in facts, or is it a dream? Is it art, or is it a factual tale? You see, right? You know, right there we get how do you bring these two together and come with, well, the whole? You see the ambiguity. This would be the double bind is of the movie. The double bind is, this is the tale of boy with the cook, or this is a tale, is it that, or this is it a tale with the boy and the tiger? Which is it? If you say it's one, you're wrong. If you say it's the other, you're wrong. But you have to, but there has to be one. So where is the one? Okay? Where's the counter?
The book, but I didn't read it, and I gave it to the Goodwill before I read it.
Oh.
But I'm wondering, several times I brought it out and started to read it. I like to be entertained when I read. Yeah. I don't read to think a whole lot.
Right.
I'm wondering if I had read the book, would I have come to a conclusion, one or the other? Would I have figured out that there were these two?
I don't know. You know, I didn't read the book. See, I just saw the movie twice.
Usually a book contains more details.
Yeah. I mean, you have to fill in your imagination. It's like listening to radio. You have to imagine the scenery.
I'm wondering if I'd need the cliff notes or a summary of the book to figure out what I just read.
There's different means. I know that... all right, well, take Avatar. Avatar. Did y'all see Avatar? These are my two favorite. No.
You got a lot of movies to catch up on.
All right, they're both on DVD. All right, so anyway, Avatar and these two movies, I don't know if they've created anything like that since then, but these two movies to me are classic, mythic metaphors that try to deal with ambiguity.
Game of Thrones, that's a good one.
Yeah, well, I haven't. I'm watching Breaking Bad now, so that's...
Oh, that's the best.
So I'm working on that now. We'll talk about that when I finish. Okay, so but anyway, Avatar, briefly, if you recall, is a classic ambiguity of who am I? So this character, Jake Sully, goes to Pandora, which is this science fiction, and there is a war between the sky people, which is the human people, logic, certainty, science, machines, against the natives, Navi, who are heart people. Right? They're organic. They're in harmony with nature. Everything is felt. They have no sense of logical certain. They have no sense of separate individual self images like the Scott people have.
I call them deep.
Huh?
Deep thinking.
Yes. Well, they don't even. No, they're really not thinking people. They're tribal people. So, anyways, Jake Sully here. Becomes the sky people have invented these robots that were alive, but the human had to go to sleep and enter into the body of the robotic Navi and animate it, and like Trojan horses, and go into the Navi tribe, you know, to get information or whatever. So they were like Trojan horses. But you had to go to sleep in order to wake up as the Navi. So Jake Scully does that, and he begins to awaken to his own being or heart as a Navi. He felt his body. See, he was paralyzed, and so he was able, when he was in the avatar body, he was able to run and have great thought. It would be. So he discovers being. It's like your relaxation. He discovers his being by letting go his thinking mind, went to sleep, you see. Like in a casket, it was really interesting when you did it. You get into this casket and you go to sleep and you wake up in the body of the, in this other reality. Not looking at the other reality as an object, but being as the other reality. See the difference? The sky people were looking at the Navi like objects. Well, you know, there's no magic trees, you can pull up one tree, they're all the same, you know. They were objectified. But so he began to know the Navi as subjective. And so now he went through a crisis where he said, I don't know whether I'm, where being a sky people is real or whether being a Navi is real. I don't know. It's like when you wake up in the morning from a strong dream and you don't know if the dream was real and what you're waking up to is a dream, or whether the dream was a dream and you're waking up to reality. You're in a little intermediate zone. I think everybody's probably had that experience where you have that little intermediate zone where you don't know which is real. So that kind of like is ambiguity experienced, where you're in a little intermediate zone . Okay, here's reality, here's dream, and here is
me.
And here's this intermediate zone where you don't know which one is real. Is it this or is it this? All right, so for a moment, you don't know. So in the avatar, there was that moment. He was walking around the Navi were mad at him and the sky people were mad at him. And he was in this intermediate zone. Who am I? Okay? And he could not answer the question. Okay? This, or that zone right there, it's called by the way, this is called the Vesica Pisces. It's a Christian, actually, an ancient, a lot of the architecture of the ancient temples were based on the Vesica Pisces. This is where Christ abides. It's also fish, which is a symbol of Christ. It's also the entrance to the cathedrals. It's also a symbol for the womb of the world. It's also a symbol where the ambiguity or the pairs of opposites meet. This is the center of this circle and the periphery of this circle. So if you put these together, you would have one circle with the center here and a periphery there. Okay? Now this center here is I, and this here is me as object. Okay, me as object. So when you're doing the relaxation and the instructor says, relax, be aware of your foot, what we first do naturally is start thinking about the foot as an object. So I'm already, I'm splitting, you see what's happened here is, see, this is foot, right? Foot as an object. But at the same time, there is the counter, the 10 men. There are 10 objects, but I count 9. Because I'm not counting the me as center. Because me as center is not an object. Getting back to our relaxation, there's foot as object, toes as object, knee as object, and I go around relaxed and relax all these objects. But the practice takes you beyond that to where there is no object. So when you totally relax the tension of having to know a world as an object, you relax the tension of having to know yourself as an object, and then you become both. This awakens. I awakens. In our culture, this is asleep. You're just a bunch of objects, sky people, running around, objects talking about objects. There is no center. Unless you get into a religion that gives you a center, but that religion is always going to be an object, an idea. Or you get with a political guy, a political leader, and that political leader will be the center. So we have false centers. Religion calls them false idols. In other words, we have to stabilize this thing to prevent psychosis. So we have to stabilize the world in order to prevent chaos. Are y'all hanging with me?
Any questions anyone has?
I have.
Yeah.
For me, right now in my life, I find on this huge subject that for me, it is not to discover the one or seek the one. It is to be comfortable in the ambiguity because it's always there. I don't have to seek it. It's always there. And our security.
Right.
Or be comfortable in insecurity. Blah, blah, blah. The same story. Yeah, I'm okay. And let's see. I had an example of that, but I've lost it, of course. But, like in the meditation and or in life, and I'm making a decision, when I relax with the decision, if you will, all the ambiguity, if you want to call it, disappears.
Yeah.
And then I know what I'm... I'm not doing it because it's good or right.
No.
I'm just doing it.
And it usually just happens.
Yes.
It's not something you can make happen.
No. But relaxation and meditation...
I'm glad you brought that up, because that kind of like finishes where we're trying to get here, is how do you contain the ambiguity, which you could call stress. All right. The stress of this is this and this is not this. The stress in the meditation is I'm going to relax my foot. Yoga nidra is the same thing. I'm going to relax my foot. So this is my foot, and this idea of my foot is not the foot. You see, so there's an ambiguity there. There's a tension there that makes me want to stay with the idea that there is a foot. If I give up the idea that there is a foot and just relax with the being, which has no boundary, you see, then I'm containing the ambiguity, but I'm losing my center, which is the thinker of my foot. See, as long as I'm thinking about my foot, I exist. If I stop thinking about my foot, the thinker goes. There's nobody thinking if there's no thought. So, trying to sum up here, is that all of these double binds and this stress of me against the world is spiritually pushing us, whether we like it or not, to the leap or shift where I contain the opposites of the world in myself, and the experience of that is being okay no matter what happens. If I feel that I'm okay no matter what ambiguities the world presents to me, I have contained the ambiguities of the world in myself, and I restore my center. The story in the Bible is about what I like about Jewish history is that the Bible, or the Old Testament, is really a history of the evolution of consciousness. And it starts out with the Hebrew people as being separate tribes, families, patriarchs, and whatever. And they go to, and I'm not a Bible expert, but I'm just what I get from it. And they go to Egypt, and they go into bondage there. And they become unified as a people, and they escape Egypt. They have a leader, Moses, and he leads them. So they go into Egypt as a fragmented people, the patriarchs, and they come out as a people. So they go in ambiguous, who am I, and they come out as the people, you see, and they go to the promised land, and they create their home. And God resides. God, the Yahweh, God is the center that holds the people together, and he resides in a temple in Jerusalem. That's, if you want to know God, you got to go to the temple. He resides in a physical place. Then the Romans come, and the Jews are getting a snit with the Romans, and they come and destroy the temple and kick them out. So what do they do now? They've lost their center. They create a portable center called the Torah.
A portable center.
All right, or the Bible.
Like that.
What?
I like that. Portable center.
Yeah, well, the Bible.
No, it's a great expression.
The Bible's a portable center.
Yeah,
I mean,
yeah, yeah.
If you've got the
Quran,
Bible,
or...
if you've got the Bible or the Torah, wherever you go, you've got God. So now I can go all over the earth, and as long as I have the Torah. There was a movie with Wilder, the guy that died. Gene Wilder, and there was a movie about him as a little Jewish rabbi who had to go west to bring the Torah to some Jews who were out in California. And he had to hook up with his gunslinger. And I forgot the name of it, but it was all these adventures he had. And he had to get this Torah to the people so they would have God, you see. But the point was the Jews survived because they made God portable. Well, see, this is a metaphor for us. Now, if we say Trump is my center, or if I say Christianity or my religion is my center, or if I say whatever I use, my husband is my center, or my wife is my center. You see, people do this, you know. Or the matriarch, you know, grandma's the center. Everybody goes to grandma's because she holds the family together. Or it could be grandma. Father knows best, you know. That's the center. So we all have these centers in layers going out that hold us in place. But all these centers, you see, are conditional. They all die. You see, so if my center is conditional, I have made it an object out here. You see, I have no center that is in the heart, that is unconditioned. My center is conditioned by logic, by certainty, by reason. Trump is a reasonable man. See, so I go with him as a, you know, or whatever. Whatever the all religions have a center. Whatever. So, you know, so all these centers that I adopt to stabilize me are on the periphery. I'm not there. I'm just counting the people, but the counter is not there. So when the counter awakens, I'm okay whether I have whatever I have. I can still go to church, I can still do this or that.
Or not.
Or not. but I'm okay. I see. So I don't, my identity does not depend on something external to me. And the feeling of that is, I'm okay and the world is okay. You see? If the world is not okay, then I'm basing my identity on the world being not okay. Which is kind of like what Trump is doing. He's saying America is crap, it's gone to hell, and all that, you see. So, but we're okay because the world is bad. Or whatever you want to formulate it, but the only one that is heartfelt, that is in the heart, is I'm okay and the world is okay. And so that ends the ambiguity. Okay, any questions?
So I think to end on problem-solving note, when we say, we against the world, right?
Yes.
Stress is created when we against the world, or I have a problem with my sibling or husband or whatever.
Yeah.
So if we change that and say, I'm okay, whatever it is, because when we are obsessing with that, we have made center of that. So if you say that, okay, no matter what it is, I'm okay. Then you keep going within. Then you bring center back to yourself within. And you regain your center and you become one with the nature.
Yeah.
You literally become,
yeah.
When you say, I'm one with the universe, the center is within and you don't have any problem.
And that, you know, yeah, and Yoga Nidra really lays out the instruction for that, because
yeah,
it starts
okay,
off by saying, welcoming every perception. So that means if I'm in a conflict,
yeah.
a perpetual conflict with another person, that means that I am not allowing them to be ambiguous.
Yeah.
I want them to be this or that. I can't allow them to be ambiguous, because that makes me ambiguous. See what I mean? So I have to judge them as being good or bad, and that creates a conflict because nobody is good or bad, or right or wrong. You see, we're all ambiguous. Life is ambiguous. Life is right and wrong. So everything we do is both right and wrong. Whatever I do is going to be good for some people, but somebody is going, eventually, whatever I do is going to create some pain for somebody. So we're always operating in an ambiguous world that is not perfect or one or the other. It's always going to be ambiguous. Right? So, and the key out, you know, and the way out is by realizing, getting back to our noble truths, the first noble truth is recognizing that I'm in a double mind. There it is. The next one is, what's the cause? Well, the cause is my perception that the world is going to have to be this and not that. So when I see that it's my perception that is causing the double mind, then I relax the idea of me as a judger, and that drops me into the heart. That drops me into the heart that allows me to be, I'm okay. And then the Eightfold Path are the things you can do to recreate this, because it keeps, in other words, you want to establish yourself as being able to be, to rediscover this truth on the go, because the world is always going to be full of squirrels. You're always going to have a bird feeder you're trying to protect from the squirrel. Yeah.
That was good, thanks.
Okay, so I guess we covered all the points.
Got
we got to Pablo Escobar, and Avatar, and Michael Pye. Yeah, mystical, mystical means mysterious. And mysterious means not certain, So it's not logical, it's not certain. It can be either or, I don't know. And no, one final point. When the opposites of ambiguity are contained, it generates creative energy. If you'll notice, this looks like a little embryo. Two opposites, the male and female, come together and create life. And it's energy. It's growing. Okay? It's alive. Right? So we all have within us this embryo that's crying out to be born. It's crying out to be born as a whole self that is not divided into this and that. See? So when these opposites come together, it is mystery. It's mysterious. Oh my God, how could this happen? How could this baby be born? How mysterious that is. How wondrous that is, you see. How wondrous, how wonderful it is. And that wonder and that mystery happens when the opposites are contained in the whole. Okay.
So why would you want to contain all those mystical movements in your brain?
Well, you can't.
I know. That's why I don't want
to. And that's it. You see, it's always a dance in trying to contain it. And when you contain it by saying, I know what it is. But if you allow the mystery to remain, this is what the yoga nidra, you know. In other words, the person that you're having a problem with, either yourself or the person, has something, a double mind. If you allow it to be mysterious, which means you don't know what it is, if you allow that to happen, you will allow the mystery to be contained in you as a center, which is mysterious in itself. You see, we're all mysterious beings. We don't know who we are. As soon as I say I know who I am, I have divided myself into I'm this but not that, and I've created a boundary around me, which is an idea. Now I've become an image. And now we're in the Mad Men, what was Don Draper's problem? He couldn't get out of the image he created of himself. You see, so an image of myself is a thing, is an idea, and I have to maintain it. So it's kind of like trying to maintain an ice cube in a bowl of hot water. Life's the water, the ice cube is the idea of me. And life's going to melt it, but I freeze it up, you see. So the whole practice is to let it melt. Yeah, let it melt. Okay, folks, thank you so much.
Thank you. Don't forget to download the app.
Okay.